life has a rhythm. It's an ongoing rhythm. It doesn't stop for anything. And I like to think within that rhythm is a soundtrack. It's our soundtrack to life. We each create our own individual soundtrack to life within that rhythm. That rhythm keeps going no matter what. It stays right on track and it keeps going. So what happens when we get off beat? When we fall out of rhythm, does our soundtrack keep going? Do we have to get our soundtrack back in rhythm? What happens if we completely lose track of that rhythm? This is what happened to me. Things are so different now. On top of my MS, I have sleep apnea, and so I sleep with a breathing mask. I wake up in the mornings and I check to make sure my legs are working and my arms are working. I didn't used to have to do that, but sometimes they don't work now. So I check everything and make sure it's all cool, and I start to get out of bed. I'd never even thought about having to do this in the past, but now it's an everyday deal that I just run through. Once I see that my arms are working, my legs are working, sometimes it's slow getting up. It's always a test to see if my legs are going to hold my body weight up or not. So I take it kind of slow most mornings, slide my shoes on and start to get up. And I hope that my legs are going to hold me. Some mornings they do, some mornings they don't. That's what determines my day. Some mornings I start off slow and things get better as I go. Some mornings they're fine. Some mornings I can't get up at all. It's a day-by-day test to see what's going on. This is the first test of the morning. I think to understand why I'm doing what I'm doing, we need to back up first to see where it all started, in kind of a condensed version. Never really even thought things would change. I just wanted to play music and that's what I was doing. I played guitar night and day. I lived in clubs and bands. Music was my life. Music defined me. I worked so hard, and eventually it came effortlessly. If you'd have told me back in 1992 or 93 that one day I would be checking every morning to see if I was going to be able to walk, I'd have laughed at you. I'd never even heard the word MS. Multiple sclerosis. I had no idea what it was. Why would I? I didn't know anybody with it. I hadn't heard about it. I was just moving closer to my goal, my dreams, playing music all the time. That's all I did, man. Practice and play. Club, night after night after night. Rehearsals. Road trips. I stayed in one band a few years, moved on to another band. Things were good and bad. Just like life, there were good times and bad times. My bands were getting bigger and bigger, and things just looked incredible for me. I had a family, had awesome kids, beautiful wife. I thought things were just going great. It's funny how life throws a curveball at you. Just when you think everything is how you wanted it, how you dreamed about it, that's when the punch in the gut comes. And it's up to you to decide where you're going to go from there.
Hey, Rachel Perry here from VH1, and this is Blockbuster TV. That was Tin Henry with Inside Out from their latest album, Twisted. Okay, back in the early 90s, Tin Henry used to play the club scene with bands like Sugar Ray and LA Guns. Now, they're trying to break out nationwide with a new album and a brand spanking new video. Log on to Blockbuster.com to get all the best in movies, soundtracks, and video games. Stick around, there's more Blockbuster TV coming up after this.
My last band before MS hit me was playing in a show in Laughlin, Nevada, a Las Vegas bike rally. It was a huge crowd and we had a great time, but I knew something wasn't right. That was one of the last shows I played. MS hit me like a bomb. The music was over, or at least I thought it was.
So, anyway, that's kind of a look back quickly as to what happened before I was diagnosed, after I was diagnosed with MS, and it's been a good chunk of time trying to figure out how to do things and who I was and why I was here and all that. Then I decided that I did want to play music. And I tried. It was like having broken hands. My brain knew I wanted to do it. I knew the chords, but my fingers were supposed to go. So I wouldn't go there. It was so frustrating that I gave up several times. Little by little, I chomped away and started slowly learning to play again. Couldn't do anything with my fingers, my hands, so I would try to play so long that my fingers would bleed because I had no idea how much pressure I was putting on the strings. I knew if it sounded right or didn't sound right, and if it sounded right, I thought I was doing it right. So I played until I couldn't take the pain anymore in my hands with not from the strings or the bleeding, but from hands getting cramps or just pain from moving them around. So that went on quite a while until I got to a point where I was comfortable with trying to do some small stuff. It was, looking back now, I know that a lot of things probably were related to MS before I was actually diagnosed. Walked away from a lot of stuff back before I was diagnosed, and I just thought that was part of my personality, was to get to a certain point and to just walk away from bands, relationships, all kinds of stuff. And looking back, I know now that the pain that I was in, the fatigue, the depression, all that stuff goes back to MS, and it is what it is. Walked away from two bands that were doing really good. One developmental deal, record deal. One band I did walk away from, Tin Henry, and probably 97 or 98, and told them I was just burnt out. And the truth is, I was really depressed about a lot of stuff, and in a lot of pain with stuff, and I just couldn't do it anymore. So, walked away. So, could you give just a brief, simple explanation of what MS is?
Sure. It's a disease that affects the central nervous system, mainly the myelin or the insulation on the nerves. It's felt to mainly be an autoimmune process, one where your body's immune system goes awry, attacking its own myelin. So if you think about the analogy of wiring in your home, if you strip the insulation off of the wire, similar thing happens to the nerves, and that can cause neurological deficits. It can involve either the spinal cord or white matter in the brain. Symptoms can be tingling, numbness, weakness, visual change. So that's sort of a simplified version.
You may not remember anything, because I know you've got billions of patients, but if you could kind of just explain the process of what I did, what I went through with my diagnosis of MS when it very first came.
Well, I may not get everything correct, but I do remember you'd already had imaging studies, you'd had sensory symptoms and some issues with walking, mm-hmm. You know, numbness in the legs, arms, maybe the trunk as well.
Yeah.
So I think you'd already had your scans, which were suggestive of MS, and then, of course, I think we then did a spinal tap.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And I hate needles. Yeah. I can't stand these.
Essentially, just to get more data, make sure that from a laboratory standpoint that we weren't missing something else.
And what is the lumbar puncture, spinal tap, tell you exactly?
Well, the lumbar puncture is, you know, part of, can be used as part of the diagnostic criteria, mm-hmm. For MS. So we use revised McDonald criteria, and a lumbar puncture, if it's positive, is for oligoclonal bands, which is just a test that looks at different proteins in the spinal fluid. If that's positive, then that is, you know, consistent with the diagnosis. It's not specific, so lumbar puncture doesn't have to be done as part of the diagnostic criteria, but it can.
You made me do one.
but it is consistent with and helps to exclude also other things that can mimic multiple sclerosis. So, you know, it's true, not all patients need a lumbar puncture, but you do need to make sure that we've looked at all the requisite labs to exclude other things that can look like MS.
Right.
There's not just a single blood test or one definitive test that says this is MS.
Right.
So you still need, you know, MRI findings, clinical findings. You need to look at laboratory studies and sometimes spinal fluid.
Okay. when somebody takes something away from you that you've done for so long, things that you take for granted, walking, picking something up, tying your shoe, whatever, then the next day you can't do it. It's a feeling I can't even describe. I still can't tie my shoes, can't button buttons. I'm always in a t-shirt or a, you know, something without buttons, zipping my pants up, stuff like that. You don't think about it.
I just wanted, I guess, somehow to put it that I think that the message needs to be clear that, well, you can adapt. If you can't feel your hands, there are ways that you can, you know, create your music. You may just have to make adaptations. And I think a lot of people do that. Mm-hmm. I've seen a lot of patients who don't do that, who readily accept a disability and probably, you know, miss out on accomplishing a lot of things that would really, you know, bring them a lot of satisfaction. So, yeah. You know, I just wanted to say that I, you know, appreciate that you're, you know, pursuing your dream despite, you know, not being able to feel your hands. You know? Yeah. As a musician, I know that's important, and I think that over the years I've seeing how that has been very discouraging for you, you know, yeah. But at the same time, I really respect that you're forging ahead, you know, creating your music. I think that's important.
And how wonderful my music is.
And
you never know what's going to happen with MS. You can go to the store, be walking through the store, get tired, have to sit down, and can't get back up. You can have days where nothing at all is wrong. You can go outside, do yard work, be fine. And then people see you do things like that and they think, there's nothing wrong with him. He's full of shit. What they don't know is 24 hours a day for the last 8 years, I've felt like I have broken ribs. Hard to breathe because of that. My feet, my shins are numb, my hands are numb, and none of it's gone away. It's there all the time. I don't know if it'll ever go away. But I look okay, so everything must be okay, right? Doesn't work that way. Just because you look okay, if you have MS, does not mean you feel okay.
Hospital visits, MRIs, neurologist appointments, and steroid infusions all became a part of my life, along with daily medications, morning, noon, and night. It seemed like medications were just all the time. Plus, MS therapies. I did self-injections for a little over 3 years, and then I moved to infusions. I would go to an MS infusion clinic, and they would hook me up and pump the MS drugs into me for 2 hours. This happened once a month, every 28 days, for 2 hours, I would receive the MS therapy. This seemed to be helping, and I stayed on it for a little over 4 years. I'd found out that there was a chance I could get some other difficulties with this, so I chose to move on. I'd become tired of feeling like a human pincushion. Even though you think you get used to it, you never really do. Everyone at the clinic was great and would take awesome care of me. But there comes a time where you just are burnt out, you've had enough, you want to move on. It was at this time that I was lucky enough to find a pill that was coming out on the market. I watched research on it for over a year, and I was one of the first ones to get on the drug as soon as it came out.
So I had this crazy idea to make a CD, only had a few things that were stacked against me, I guess. The first was, I had MS and my hands were numb, so I had to learn how to play the guitar all over again with numb hands, and I've been doing that for the last 10 years almost. My second hurdle was I didn't have a band, and my third was I had to learn to record everything here at home because I didn't have money to go into a studio. So my playing pretty much sucked. So I would play tracks over and over again and record, take the each section of the song and splice them, take the best sections, piece them together until I had the songs, and that's how everything started. I approached the guitar differently, quite a bit differently, during this CD than I had in the past. In the past I had used some drop D tuning, and this time around I experimented with a lot of open tunings and drop D, where I would drop the E string down to a D and the bottom E to a D. The reason I did this was I have trouble with my fingers making the chords quickly as they're supposed to, because my fingers don't really want to go where they need to go. Sometimes they will, sometimes they won't, and I can't feel them. So with dropping the D, the E to a D, I was able to use one finger, and I could just slide that finger back and forth. That I had taken during this process. The second process that I used was I did play in standard tuning on some stuff, and I didn't have a lot of key changes, chord changes. Again, I would have to constantly watch where my fingers were going. Originally, I wanted to go to a C there, which would be like this. But I couldn't get my fingers there fast enough, so I opted to go stay in like a G position. And the third trick that I used was the capo. Everybody uses one at one time or another playing the guitar. So again, I was able to stay in the G position as far as my fingers were concerned and play it in different places on the neck and get different sounds through that. Another thing that enabled me to do was use one finger bar chords with the capo on. So that's the three basic cheats, tricks that I used for stuff, because I have to watch my fingers constantly and I have to find ways to kind of cheat the chords around and have a little help getting some pressure on the strings. That's what one of the or three of the tricks I used. Another thing that really hindered me was the guitar pick. I have a very hard time holding a guitar pick and playing at the same time. I used to take the pick and put on my thumb and then my finger, then I would wrap duct tape around these two fingers, thumb and finger, so that I wouldn't drop it, because I constantly drop picks during playing. My fingers are numb, so that I would constantly put too much pressure, not enough pressure on the strings, they would bleed. I would tear them up. I would drop picks, get frustrated. Eventually, I abandoned the pick altogether and just played with an open hand. So a lot of times I would pretend like I was holding a pick because I couldn't tell the difference in holding one and not holding one. Sometimes I'd be playing and look down and realize, I dropped my pick, but I was still strumming. So that's another one of the adaptations that I had to make. So, and this is what I play mainly on the Amazing Tragedy Circus CD. So that was the beginning of modifying things for me and what I did to learn to play the guitar again was watching where I was playing and playing a lot slower, and then eventually building up speed, and then I would play it, you know, as cleanly as I could, and luckily with, you know, computers and stuff, I could speed up the tempo a little bit if I needed to make things sound like I wanted. So that's kind of where I am, and today it's even harder to fret things and play the way I need to make it sound like I want, because I hear an orchestra in my head and it doesn't come out of my fingers like that anymore. So songwriting is a bit of a challenge. But anyway, that's how I've done it, and how I'll try to continue to do it for as long as I can. every song I did started off with me and a click track. So I wrote the songs, and I basically started with nothing other than this. That was the only sound I heard, was a click track. No drummer, no bass, nothing. Just a click track. After I had my click track in, I would record my guitar part. So after my guitar part was recorded, I would have a click track, and I would have a guitar. And that would be how everything would start to come together. To go back and I record my vocals. I would listen to the click track in my guitar and I would sing.
When I'm feeling down,
so I would end up with
how she picks me up. When the things get tough,
I would just have my vocals, my guitar, and a click track. The next thing I did was call upon some friends to come over. In this case, it was Chris Clarity on the guitar. We sat down, worked on songs, recorded his parts.
Man, it's pretty frustrating sometimes looking at the screen. You have to pretty much watch the screen where the arrow is. In my hand to make sure I'm in the right place, and then if I try to grab something or whatever, then it's like double duty. So that's why I'm so slow with stuff.
It's not good. Yeah.
I see. What do you think?
Would it be easier to learn the shortcuts on the keyboard? Probably not.
I have a really hard time with keyboards too.
Okay.
Like Facebook and a lot of stuff like that is I have talk to text on my phone, so it's easy just to hit that one button and say whatever, you know. But then if I type or try to type with stuff, autocorrect sometimes helps me and sometimes kills me.
Right.
You know, yeah. Stuff.
Yeah, I can relate to that.
Dude, I didn't mean to say, I'd like to kiss your butt. You know? Okay, I guess I'll start it all the way over again and let's do another pass.
Yeah.
Like you were saying. And
same idea.
Okay. And I got everything. I got your last two guitars muted.
Yeah.
sometimes recording didn't go as planned. I would have days I would get knocked down. I would have fatigue. I couldn't hold the guitar. I couldn't even get out of bed. I didn't think it was necessary to show clips like that. Maybe just one picture would show you kind of how my days were when I was knocked down and in bed or on the couch. Couldn't move, couldn't hold the guitar. I just had to wait until the next day and see if I was going to be able to make something happen or not. So that's what I did. I just waited and prayed for the next day to come when I'd be able to play.
This is where things started getting tricky because I had already gone against the grain with recording these instruments out of the normal way that you would. My really good friend Patrick Martin, who was involved through the whole process with this and a big, big asset to have, recorded a lot of instruments on this song. The first one he recorded was the bass guitar. After Patrick recorded the bass guitar, listening back to stuff, we started tweaking it, and it started coming together now. I had Chris Clarity and Patrick on bass, my guitar, my vocals. Things started clicking. At this point, it's really starting to sound more like a song. For the song, it was time to start having fun. So Patrick went back and added quite a few instruments. I added some stuff. We started tweaking things. Drums, bongos, kabasa, shakers, keyboards, and the song really started coming to life at this point. Coming together was pretty incredible because none of us were ever in the same room at the same time as a whole band. There would be one person at a time over. Sometimes Patrick and I would just exchange files across the internet, and to produce something like this ended up being pretty amazing, in my opinion. When the things get tough, she says it ain't enough. It can't bring you down. You've seen too much. And I keep going. In the end, to produce something that sounds like an entire band time, and that was the far from the truth. And I had another friend of mine, Catherine, come over, and she added background vocals, which really, really put a soft touch on the feel of the song. I guess the thing that was the craziest about all of this is the way we put the songs together piece by piece, the amount of time it took, because in the past it would take me, you know, a few weeks, a month to record a CD with a band, but going back and forth, coordinating, getting friends to volunteer their time to come over and record was kind of a task. But my friends came through in the, you know, in the end, and showed up and helped me do this stuff. The CD took 11 months to complete. A song took a long time just to do one song. So it was frustrating at times where you think, oh my gosh, I'm never going to finish this. And then when the songs started coming together and all the pieces were added, it turned out to be just an awesome feeling, because I had done a couple of CDs in the past after I was diagnosed with MS, but they were nothing on the level of this. And this is what I wanted to do. I wanted to make a full-blown CD and show others with MS that we can do this. I can keep making music. It doesn't take me a month or a few weeks to do it anymore. It took me almost a year to get this CD out and stuff. And I had, you know, I didn't have money to go in the studios. I wasn't able to book time because I didn't know if I'd be able to show up, if I'd be able to get up and walk that day or not. So the best option for me was to record it here at home. So with what little I had, microphones, guitars and stuff, I did the best I could. And with the computer, just a cheap little program that I got that worked really good for me, that's called Acid. It was amazing to use that program. I'd used other programs in the studios and, you know, at home in the past before MS. I'd used some software to record, but this one was one of the not more expensive softwares, because they can get very expensive very fast. And so I went with one that was easy to use, because I can't do a lot of work on the computer because my hand falls off the mouse and I'm not sure where it is, and picking parts and just maneuvering on the keyboard is hard. I can hardly do it. So that's how we built the songs, and how I keep saying we, because it was really, I did a lot of the stuff, but I had one of my best friends, Patrick. He actually only came over one time to record here and do stuff, and the rest of the time we were sending files back and forth online, and adding stuff back and forth and talking about it, and then adding more stuff, and then I would have a friend over to cut some parts. And so it was the band, all the instruments were never together in a room at the same time. It was just physically impossible to do that. And I don't think unless you watch this and you hear me say that you would never know that all the instruments weren't recorded at one time. Some of the songs we would work, Patrick and I would work on, and maybe 2 or 3 months before just that one song was done, because we had gone and added stuff to another song, then would let it sit for a while and listen to it. So that's my point, is I guess keep adapting and don't give up on what you want to do, because I'm living proof that, you know, I said I was going to make this CD, I said I was going to make it on a big scale, and it's done now, and it's actually, I put the time in, put it online, and I went through the channels. It's on iTunes, on Google Music. The hard copies are on my website, and I had people that believed in what I was doing, and they chipped in. I was able to scrape together a few $100 and get copies of the CD made, and I've given most of those away, so it wasn't about, you know, making money or a number one hit song. It was about getting this thing done and not letting MS stop me from doing what I love to do. It was hard. It is hard. I used a lot of tricks along the way. I don't play the guitar the way I used to, so I did the best I could. So why did I do this? This started out and is a music project. It just so happened that I am a musician with MS, so I chose not to show a lot of things that happened when I have attacks and not feeling well, just because I've seen so many documentaries on MS, and it focuses so much on getting knocked down, and they do succeed with stuff, but when I get knocked down, the things are, you've seen most of that in descriptions of MS and other documentaries and stuff, and when I get knocked out, I can't get out of bed. I can't walk. I can't hold the guitar. I can't do what I need to do. Sometimes it lasts for a day, sometimes a week, sometimes 2 weeks. I just never know. It's not like having a cold and you know that you're going to be better in a few days or a couple of weeks. So that was one of the things that I wanted to stress for others with MS, that, yeah, used to I could do a CD with a band or, you know, a group of guys and get it knocked out quick. And this time it took 11 months to do a CD that should have taken, you know, a month maybe. And my point is, don't give up. I mean, keep doing what you're doing, find new ways to do it, and it will, you know, you'll get to the finish line. You just have to take some time to get there. And I chose on purpose not to show that stuff, because I wanted to show all of the positive sides of things. So that was a big thing for me, because first and foremost, this was a music project. A lot of people will see this CD online on the shelves and stuff, and they'll never know that I have MS. It's all about the music. If it's good music, it'll do well. It's if it gets on the radio, it'll be because it's a good song, not because I have MS. So I kind of wanted to let you into my world of what I go through to get things done. There were times where I couldn't play for days, couldn't play for weeks. I waited. I would try the next day. If I could play, I could play. If I couldn't, I couldn't. If I could get out of bed, I could. If I couldn't get out of bed, then I couldn't. But I knew that, you know, I had an end game in sight. I wanted to get this done as long as it took to get it done, and with the help of a few of my friends on parts that I couldn't play anymore.
I was able to do that. So that's why I didn't show a lot of falling down or sleeping in the bed, laying on the couch, struggling to walk. I just didn't feel like it was necessary to show that stuff. It happens. Those of you that know me know that it happens, and I wanted to show the positive with things. There are a couple of things that are in here that, you know, struggling playing the guitar and stuff like that, and I felt like that was enough to get my point across. And the main thing is the music and not giving up. And that's why I made the Amazing Tragedy Circus CD. So if you guys would like more information or to pick the CD up, you know, you can go to my website, Chris Cox Rocks, and grab it, support what I do. I will be doing another CD. I'm already thinking about it. I've had a little bit of a break between finishing and filming this section here. So I think the next one I would like to try to do completely by myself. I don't know if that's possible or not, but there won't be filming or documentary or anything on that. So it wasn't really intended when this one started. It just kind of grew into that, and wanted you to see what I did, what I went through to get these things done. And taking almost a year to get the CD out was something that was frustrating at times and painful, but, you know, didn't want to give up. And that's how I want you guys to approach things. Don't give up. Just keep trying. Take a break if you need to, but keep pushing forward to finish what you started. And that's the whole message of this thing, is we can show others that we are able to do things. It may take us longer, but we can. And I wish everyone the best of luck in what you do with MS, because it puts a new light on, you know, the MS society, and we need, you know, help from others at times, and you shouldn't be ashamed to ask for that help. And that's one of the things that keeps my projects going too, is helping my friends and people donating to the projects to get things printed and get equipment to do stuff. And it's going to be a big push for submitting this to film festivals, and I need a lot of help and support from you guys to do that. So that's pretty much it, and I hope you guys have enjoyed this journey with me, and we'll see where it goes from here. Peace, love. Peace. Thank you. of my songs that I posted on the internet, a home video for, is going crazy all of a sudden. Thank you.